last four years, I've had a company called Isidore Electronics Recycling. And so we are an electronics, an electronics recycling company. And our sort of special sauce is not, I mean, we recycle electronics properly and we don't throw them in the river. We make sure that they're properly treated and recycled and made into new things. But basically our special sauce is that we hire folks who've come out of the criminal justice system. So people who have, as we say, people who face severe barriers to work. So for the most part, that's formerly incarcerated people. Also some formerly homeless and some what is called disconnected youth, which are young people who are no longer in the school system for whatever reason, not yet in prison, and we're trying to not have them get into that prison part of it. So obviously that's what you thought I did when you saw me, which is not true. So I'll just tell a little bit about, because I'll get into the nitty-gritty of Isidore and what that is. Isidore, by the way, is the patron saint of computers and the internet and computer repair people. Since 1999, the Catholic Church made a saint for all that, so that's we named ourselves after that saint. May he bless us all. So just a little bit of a tale about how I got here, because I think that in the world of social innovation and social enterprise, it's not a normal road, and it's not one that is sort of delineated out for how you do life. So I'll just offer mine for whatever interest it might have. But so I'm from Philadelphia. I grew up in the suburbs of Philadelphia. I grew up in the 90s there, went to high school and college. And as I like to say, I was always an activist. I was always really interested in social change and saving the rainforest and, you know, women's rights and all of this. And but what my real passion was actually costume design. I wanted to be a costume designer. I loved fashion and I wanted to sew and go to Broadway and put clothes on people. And so my undergraduate degree is from Vassar College, which is out in New York, and I went up to Vassar and I studied sociology and I studied Spanish and got into the nitty-gritty of a lot of women's studies and in general just looking at poverty and the third world, as it was called then. I spent some time in Latin America. I studied abroad there, and I was very interested in these issues of just inequity and how that inequity could be resolved. But I was also in the theater doing costumes and having fun there. So I moved to Los Angeles in the year 2000. I graduated college in 99. And I was like, you know what? I have this great degree, but what I really want to do is be a costume designer. So I brought my grandmother Pat's sewing machine with me to LA, and I was sewing and like listening to NPR in my room and sewing. And so it was awesome. And then 9/11 happened. And I was 23 and completely blindsided by it. I was like, what? This is our reaction to 9/11? I was someone who was completely activated by that event. I was appalled at the way we reacted to it. I wanted a different sort of public policy to be enacted in the face of that. The war on terror was terrible to me. And I like lost my marbles. I was marching, I was going up to the Bay, we were doing all these, you know, there was all these anti-war marches. Up to the 2004 election, which was George Bush and John Kerry, I ended up in Nevada organizing, trying to get this, just try to change. I thought the country needed a big change. And I just couldn't pay attention to being a fashion designer anymore. So I did a few things. I sort of waited around in the activist world and eventually found my way to starting a nonprofit that was a group of young people who were really focused on looking at local issues as opposed to federal ones. We were like, the federal government is never going to listen to a bunch of people in their 20s. Who's actually running our city? And what does the mayor do? What is a city council person? What is a county supervisor? Like, who are these people? And what effect do they have on their lives? And what values do they have? So a bunch of us sort of organized and we started making voter guides and throwing these events. And it was cool. It felt like we were doing something. And I ended up meeting Eric Garcetti, who's the mayor of Los Angeles now, but at the time was a very young city council member. And I think he sort of took pity on me. I was such an angry little activist. And he was like, oh God, you're so angry at the government. Why don't you come see how it works? So he hired me, and which is a blessing. And so in 2005, I went to work for the city of LA as a field deputy, which is really, I mean, this is like where government meets the road is in the field office of a city council member. I mean, this is like tree trimming and potholes and are the lights working? And there's, you know, gang members hanging out in my corner. What do I do about it? And I loved it. I just was right in my element. I was like, you could actually make change at this level. This is awesome. So I lived in Silver Lake for a lot of my years in LA. And so suddenly I was the deputy for Echo Park and Atwater Village. And I don't know how well you guys know LA, but this is sort of Northeast LA up near Hollywood and all that. And suddenly I'm in this position where I'm reading the crime statistics for these neighborhoods every week. And I was completely flabbergasted. I was like, what is going on here? There seems to be people dying of gun violence in these neighborhoods. And it's like, I'm like going to brunch on Sundays and then there's people being killed because of gang violence. And I became absolutely obsessed with this. I was like, we didn't have gangs in the suburbs of Philadelphia. So suddenly, that really seemed like a place that I wanted to jump into it. And so I became sort of obsessed. There was a big report going on about what LA could do around gang violence. I read the entire 500-page document. There's a civil rights lawyer named Connie Rice, who is interestingly nodding your head. I mean, you know, she's quite a woman. She was at the helm of writing this report. I used to like stalk her in study hall and like wait behind columns to see if I could be like, hi. And she was like, you are very interested in this. And I was like, I really am. And so she was one of the first people who said, look, if you really are interested in this, because not that many people are, go become an expert. And so she was one of the first people who said, go to grad school. And I will tell you, I only applied to USC. I was like, I'm going to USC. There's an excellent program there. It was called SVPD at the time. And so I came in, and it was awesome because I came in as an adult knowing exactly what I wanted to look at, and it was these issues around, like if you look at gangs, right, you're looking at young people who are often economically disadvantaged, who are not in the best neighborhoods, who don't have access to great school or work opportunity or even like, you know, recreational activities to do. So I was looking at that, but then you immediately also run into the criminal justice system in America. So if you look at gang members, you're looking at people who are going into the criminal justice system, coming back out, going back in, this whole recidivism, the revolving door, all this stuff. So I came to USC, and it was awesome. I was like, in your class, we looked at, I think we did a cost-benefit analysis of doing vocational training inside a prison and what that means for someone once they've come out. And I did my practicum on looking at the time, like green jobs was sort of this new phrase that was going on. I think this was 2009, 2010. Looking at if you it can't be impossible to put people to work after they come out of prison, right? Like it can't be an impossible thing to do. So my group and I looked at what are the best practices around job training for people who've come out of prison, and what sort of sustainable industries could we be looking at to build to put people to work. So I took a class in the Sustainable Cities Department, which was in the Geography Department at the time. I don't know where it is now.
It's
Price. Amazing. Right on. And so in that, I've always been sort of obsessed with waste and garbage and what we do with that. And so I wrote a paper on e-waste in that class. And so electronic waste is the fastest growing waste stream in the world. It is computers and this stuff and your phones and stereos and anything basically that plugs in is electronic waste. At best, we recycle about 25% of it, which is not awesome because it is such a quickly growing stream. And the two sort of main tragedies around this are one, it is toxic. So in there is bromated flame retardants, arsenic. This is stuff that should not be in our landfills. It certainly shouldn't be in our oceans or streams, where it often ends up if it goes overseas. On the other side of it, it's also filled with precious things. So there's gold in there, there's arsenic. I'm sorry, not arsenic. There's gold, there is arsenic. There's gold, there's silver, there's palladium. There's conflict minerals like tin and tungsten, and this is literally what child soldiers are killing each other over in the Congo. What's in all of our hard drives are rare earth metals. That's in every single one of our hard drives. The one fun fact is that there are more landfilled rare earth metals than are remaining in all known mineable deposits. Like it's in our landfills. We have dug it out of the earth. All this shit we have dug out of our earth. We've blown up mountaintops. We've created plastic, all these gadgets, and then we only recycle 25% of it. So there's that environmental piece to it and our resources piece, but then to sort of step back and look at the resources piece in a broader way, it's also we can create jobs through this, right? So the vast majority of electronic waste is not only is it not recycled, but what is recycled is shipped away. So for instance, the city of Los Angeles has a contract with a company up in Fresno, California. Great, that's their contract. But why are we shipping waste to Fresno? Because along with the, you know, adding carbon footprint to our waste, that's literally jobs that the city of LA is shipping up to Fresno to be able to process this. So somewhere in the midst of all of this, my entrepreneurial screw went loose and I said, well, I feel like if this is a way to create jobs, I feel like if I asked people for their electronic waste, maybe they would give it to me and maybe I could figure out how to hire some folks to process it. And that is my weird tale of how I started Isidore.
That's really wonderful, Kabira. I know some people are, you know, in social innovation classes right now, and they were, as I was talking to Professor Grady Reed earlier, they've actually just been learning about social enterprise. And when you talk about what you've done, you actually are doing social enterprise that checks any possible box that could make something a social enterprise, which is just really phenomenal.
And we're a woman-owned business.
Yes. By boxes, we're talking about making the world more environmentally sustainable, dealing with a challenging social problem around providing jobs to, you know, ex-offenders, and all these kinds of, the list goes on. So that's just really amazing and exciting how you're able to do all that together. And it was really clear that your passion guided you, and you sought skills, and you sought all those things to prepare yourselves for the next step. And that was also really, really exciting. But along that path, you probably have learned some lessons about some of the challenges that are out there. And you know, there's a bunch of students here that are interested in social innovation and social enterprise. And you know, I wondered if you could offer some lessons about what it takes, what would you need to do, what further preparation might they need, especially if they're undergraduates right now, to get where they want to go.
So Isidore is an interesting thing, right? So we're 4 years old. We've processed over 1.2 million pounds of electronics, and we're not in the black. I raised a round at the beginning. I did a friends and family round. I was able to raise $500,000 because some people really believed in me, and my passion is like coming out of my ears. So they were like, all right, at least we know she'll go for it. That being said, I mean, so social enterprise. Well, I'll talk about this. So we're not in the black, and it's because this is an industrial sort of, you have to be to scale. Like, the more e-waste you bring in, the more jobs you can create, and the more revenue that you make. This is a crazy industry that is involved with the commodities market, which is up and down and up and down. But essentially, in our model, we did model this out. We basically, once you get to a certain poundage, we will be in the black. We just need you sort of to continue to grow. We've had excellent growth year over year. We've at least doubled both our revenue and our workforce every year. We're on track to do it again this year. It's sort of these excellent numbers. Like for any startup that doubles every year, it's an amazing thing, but we're at the sort of smaller scale. Like we'll hit about $400,000 in revenue this year. And we will just break even. And that includes some grant funding that we've received. We're a for-profit company, technically, right? So we're a B Corp. And I chose to become that because when looking at this landscape in school and all of it, in terms of workforce development for formerly incarcerated people or anyone who has a hard time getting a job, you have these amazing social service agencies. Like that's one thing that I would say LA is amazing at, right? It's not to the scale that it needs to be by any stretch of the imagination, but there is these amazing nonprofits. You have Chrysalis downtown, you have Homeboy Industries, you have these folks who are really taking people who literally don't know how to put money in a bank, who can barely get on a bus to get to work, who need clothes to get there, who do not have the soft skills that everyone in this room, we really take it for granted because we were just brought up in a different way. Well, I don't know all of you, but you're here, so, you know, awesome. A lot of folks can't figure out how to get to a place like this. So you have people getting people really work ready, but and then there's the job world, right? So here's like the, you know, you go to get a job. The truth is that people, even if they're work ready, they still have a felony. People aren't hiring people with felonies, although that's changing a bit, which is an amazing thing to watch. They're not hiring a dude with tattoos all over his face and all over his neck. Like, there's still this gulf here between being work ready out of a nonprofit and the real world. For me, and this is where like the craziness sort of comes in, it seemed to me you need to seed this valley, which is real companies that are willing to take a chance on people who might have a record, who might not have a great, you know, spotty past, but they are ready to work. And it seemed to me we need to normalize these populations. You can't just go to a nonprofit to get work. There has to be some companies that are going to step up and say, no, we'll do this. And I think I sort of crossed my fingers and I said, I think that social good part of this will be a differentiator for us. And it absolutely has been. So as a result, we get pointed to as a model of social enterprise all the time. We win awards like it's our job. Like the Kamala Harris, the Attorney General, gave me an award for being smart on crime, which is amazing. But I was like, is there a check associated with this? There was not. because we have had a tremendously hard time raising money. And it's so weird. Like, I guess it's because we're like cutting edge, or we're innovating, or whatever it is. We are a little bit too far out there right now. So you have all these impact investors, which I'm sure you guys have like taken classes on and all this stuff. Impact investing it's a real thing, but it's not fully formed and the metrics sort of aren't exactly there yet. And so even though my company gets pointed to all the time, we get press all the time, it's the whole thing. I thought that would equate to like, yes, we're gonna be able to raise the money we need to grow, we have all these amazing opportunities in front of us. It is not, because for the most part, people still wanna be able to scale in Africa. Like, the seed funding world for social, for this B Corp, for for-profit, whatever you wanna call it, social enterprise, it is not fully fleshed out. It's not there. People, it's their money. They get to be as risky as they want to be with it. But for me, there's sort of this, what are we actually valuing here, right? So there's money and there's the ability to be able to get 10x return on your money and all that. But what if you're offering 3x and a whole bunch of taxpayer savings because people aren't going back to prison? And these are the things where, in theoretically, people are like, that sounds great, but the checks aren't actually there. So I'm saying that just because there's a lot going on right now. This world is changing quickly. I think there's a lot of innovation going on. I'm only one company, and I'm not trying to like tell my sob story about not being able to raise money, but this is the seed funding piece of this is hard. So I'm just letting you know that. That is a hard piece to this. However, I feel like whatever happens with Isidore, and we're now talking to some strategic partners and there's some loans and we'll be fine. We're gonna figure this out. It is very difficult, but we will figure it out. I think that there's sort of the next wave of this, I think people are gonna figure out better than I did. And that sort of makes me feel a little bit better. Like, we've hammered our way through this and like tripped and fallen and the whole thing. But I think over the next 5-10 years, like, if y'all wanna start a business, which I think you all should, even though it is very hard, I think those paths are gonna be more and more worn, but we need more people to step up and say, I don't think we have to do this as a nonprofit. Nothing wrong with nonprofits. In many cases, that might be the right way to go forward, but I think, like, this is about capitalism and the way, and what we value in this country and in this world, and if we really do wanna change a system where it's not actually, like, money isn't the only bottom line actually that we care about. There really is a value to helping people and to the environment. I mean, this is literally what the numbers that we crunched in getting an MPP. It's like, how do you actually value this stuff? And the answers aren't all there yet, but it's like, you guys sitting in this room are gonna be in this next phase of being like, we really believe that it doesn't always have to be a nonprofit, that business can do good. So my other piece of advice, if you do start a business, always get insurance. Whatever insurance is that they are offering you, you get them because you might need them. That's real.
I just had a question because I love that you're not this traditional nonprofit, very untraditional actually. So my question is, I guess the process of how you get, I don't know if it's clients or labor? Because do they get referred to you, or do you go find them from the nonprofits they previously
worked? That's a great question. So we get referrals from nonprofits. So we're not a social service agency. I am not a social worker. I don't have the skills to hold people when they immediately have gotten out of prison. There's some very real people need wraparound services, and they need real care that we can't provide. So we work very specifically with, most successfully with two nonprofits. One is Chrysalis Downtown, another is called Friends Outside. And these are the people doing the real nitty gritty reentry work that is needed. For the most part, we won't hire someone unless they've been out for 3 months and have gone through some transitional job work. So that means they've gone, Chrysalis, the majority of their transitional work is street sweeping, cleaning bus shelters. I mean, it's the least glamorous work in the world, but it teaches people to show up on time, and if your boss gets mad at you, you don't leave or get angry or punch him or whatever. So people who have just, they've been able to acclimate and are they really are work ready. So we only hire through those agencies because they're doing the work that's needed. And that's why I chose this route, because I saw them and they get people work ready, but then there's this bottleneck because where are they putting them? So we're trying to be that next step for them. Yeah.
As this, because you said, and I totally agree that it's not fully formed, this social enterprise world.
Yeah.
But as these cross-sector types of social enterprises like yours continue to grow, do you think that there's a limit to which they can grow, where traditional capitalism will always be a major thing dominating the economy, or can this grow to where the majority of businesses, what's your
vision
for
this? This is the future of business. I think this is the future of business, because I think, first of all, because my generation and our generations, we are raised to understand that resources are finite, actually, and that if you have a business that is maybe doing good by the environment but treating its workers terribly, I mean, that stuff can't be hidden anymore, right? These things aren't happening now in the corners. With the internet and all this, we're seeing all of this stuff. And I think people still buy that stuff, but I think more and more consumers are why is my dollar going to treating some child slave who's making Hershey's candy? This is terrible, or whatever. And on the other end, if they're treating their workers really well but making some terrible plastic gadgets that's ending up in the ocean for the fish to eat, it's not a sustainable way. And I think that the smarter, the businesses that you guys might create, they're going to be smarter and more savvy to know what consumers want, but also will figure out that balance between making sure the financial bottom line is secure, but how to also do this environmental and social benefit. There's no room for single bottom line businesses anymore. The planet is melting. It's not a thing anymore. You heard it here first.
Something I know we've discussed a little bit in this class is when those organizations create these missions that have double, triple bottom line benefits, first of all, do you think that they can be truly altruistic, or are they more just responses to consumer demand? And B, does that matter at all, as long as they're making the same decision?
Right. Yes, is my answer. I mean, it's all of it, right? So, I mean, I have an advisor who's always why are you in this? Why are you in this? And I'm always I'm in this to recycle electronics. He's but why are you really in it? I'm right, I'm actually in this to create work for people. But I can't create work for people if I'm not a good electronics recycler. So it's also interwoven. And at the end of the day, yeah, if someone's taking on a social or environmental mission because they think it'll make them some money, great. But there is the tricky part about this, and I think this is the weird gray area to still be figured out around social enterprise, is that, I mean, truth be told, the second you bring the financial bottom line into the mix, there's going to be tension with one of the other ones. And the question is, how do we balance that? Because in a utopia, sure, all three will be balanced, but that's not always going to be the reality. So, I mean, I've made choices. I could have more people in my shop, but we don't, because we would be bankrupt. So, and there's a part of me that's then I should have been a nonprofit, but I don't really think that's true. So,
So considering how quickly your business model has been growing, where do you see it in like 5 years? And like at that point, would you see your model as a replicable model and sure. taking it to other places or?
Yeah, so good question. So the first sort of, the growth is the first phase. So like for instance, and this is where I get to put my public policy hat back on, I want every single piece of e-waste that comes out of LA County. I want every single piece of e-waste that comes out of USC, by the way. Y'all can maybe help me with that. Like there's LA County or the state of California, I mean, these are people who, these are huge employers. They have lots of e-waste. They also have people coming out of their correctional facilities. So in this, I mean, to step back for 1 second, 4 years ago, there was like 600 people in this country talking about criminal justice reform. The president is currently talking about it. We're all like, whoa, this is awesome. Like, there's such a sea change in the way that criminal justice reform is being spoken about. The jobs piece of it is still very much to be figured out, right? We can put money towards reentry and all these services, but there's still the job piece that's so real, because if you can't make a living, how are you going to stay out of prison for the most part? So I think it's sort of this ripe time for going to government and saying, you have a waste stream that you're not thinking about. Let's put people to work with that waste stream. So that's sort of the growth piece of it. But I think there's replication that's sort of inherent in that of being, like I have a call with the Philadelphia mayor's office tomorrow because some kid from Vassar read a thing about me and was like, I work for the mayor's office. We should do this in Philadelphia. And I was like, yes, that's correct. We should. So I think the replication is totally real and will happen. The other piece to this, interestingly, is that weirdly, we are not alone in being a social impact e-waste recycler. So we, for the last year and a half, with the help of a foundation, the REDF, the Roberts Employment Development Fund, which is a California foundation, they sort of figured out that we are not alone. So there's seven companies that hire folks with barriers to work through e-waste recycling. So people who are formerly incarcerated, people who are autistic or are in the, or have mental disabilities. So there's seven companies, and we've come together to form Impact Recyclers. That's what we're called. We have this sort of amazing geographic spread, which is we're in California, we have folks in Denver, we have folks in Minneapolis, folks in Atlanta, et cetera. And so we've actually started going after larger contracts to be able to say, like, I can't go to a national chain and say, I can service you all over the country. But now I'm like, but we can. And so we started to get business that way, which is awesome. It's only just the beginning of that, I think. And to speak sort of to your question, I think on the sourcing side of things, for the service that we offer, to be able to go to a large corporation that is like shitting all over the environment, pardon my French, or treating their workers terribly, to be able to say, here's actually a way you can do some good with, again, your waste stream that you're not thinking about. I think we get clients because of that. We get work because of our social mission. And there's a whole other piece to this on the social enterprise in that landscape, which is to have your social mission be so core to your brand. And I think that's a winning thing at this point. So yes to replication, and yeah. Yes.
What does your company's line of work look like after, say, I give you some sort of electronic waste?
Great question. So we have trucks that go out into the world and pick up trucks full of e-waste from businesses and schools and governments. We bring it back to our warehouse, which is in Chinatown. If any of you want to come visit, you are welcome to. So everything comes in, it is weighed and it is sorted. Anything with sensitive data on it goes into our double locked data room to make sure that can be dealt with properly, because I have to be paranoid about my data considering who I hire. Although we won't hire anyone who has a history of identity theft or fraud. For us, those are the crimes that make sense. But anyone else, we're pretty open to. So from there, it's basically triage. So there's things that come in that are truly at the end of their life, right? Computers from the 90s or a broken cell phone or whatever it is. So that's put over, and that's about 85% of what comes in is at the end of its life. That's basically e-scrap. And then the other 15% is actually reusable. I mean, we get perfectly usable things all the time. You can't believe what people think is garbage. I mean, like computers that have been used for 1 year and then people upgrade them, or full phone systems for an office. These are things that people will buy. So we have over half of our revenue is from that 15% of the e-waste. which is we resell online on eBay and Craigslist, and then we have a series of wholesalers that will buy from us. On the scrap side, and this is really the basis of our entry-level work, is we're actually taking computers apart with a screwdriver. So we're demanufacturing computers and essentially separating them out into their component parts. We then sell those parts downstream to our downstream end-of-life processors who have shredders the size of a house. They're shredding and trying to get at the metals and the plastic and the glass that's in there for reuse. So that's another way we make money, is selling that scrap. That is, however, what is based on the commodity market. So that we're trying to get as much as possible, not have that be such a core of our business because it's so volatile. One of the places we're trying to go next is more into this data destruction world. So with all the talk of cybersecurity and all of this, the fact remains that the data is still stored in physical devices. So how to actually destroy those correctly. So we are, and I'm gonna show you guys, I'm an entrepreneur, so I'm a hustler, so I'm gonna show you a video at the end because we're finishing an Indiegogo campaign today. And the campaign was to buy a truck and a mobile hard drive shredder. And so that we could actually, a company will pay a lot of money to physically destroy a hard drive instead of being open to the liability of whatever patient data or student data or whatever is on there. So that's another revenue stream that we're really going towards.
I'm just curious about when you first had the idea to start this business.
I thought I'm a crazy person.
It's an amazing idea. Thank you. I'm really excited about what you're doing. Who did you speak with about mentorship when you were first getting started? And what does your organization structure look like now? And what do you hope it will look like?
So I was like, this is the craziest idea I've ever had in my life. And I really did a series of, I guess, informational interviews is the best way to describe it. I sat down with sort of anyone who would talk to me and be like, I have an idea, how crazy is this? And that, you know, people would be like, that's kind of a good idea, actually. Or some people were like, you're crazy. And I was like, I know, but I'm gonna do it anyway. So from those interviews, it begat the next interviews, and it was just, who else should I talk to in this world? What do you think? And it was everything from recycling, like, does anyone know anyone who recycles? And I found an e-waste recycler in Indiana, who I went out to Indiana, and I went to their shop, and I took apart computers for a few days, and met their guys, and I was like, whoa, this is crazy, and I want to do this. And then also on the social service side of things, of anyone who's in criminal justice reform, in reentry work, in the job training pieces of this. And then also just, I didn't know anything about nothing. I'm a policy person, nothing about starting a business. So just as much advice as possible. And from there, I formed an advisory board. So people who were like, I like this idea, I'll help you do this. I had an advisory meeting last week, and I was like, God, these people have been with me for some of them 4 years since I was like, people used to ask me what I did, 3.5 years ago, if you asked me what I did, I would laugh while I said it. I'd be like, I'm an e-waste recycler who hires ex-cons, I don't know. Because it was so unbelievable to me that is actually what I was doing, because it was like, what? I want to be a costume designer, this is crazy. But to now, I mean, this is what I do. There's no laughing anymore. It's like, yeah, that's what I do every day. So information, it's just like anyone who can talk to you that you can get any advice from, and then that steamrolls. And then, so now there's 15 of us now. I'm a CEO, we have a COO, a director of administration, and a general manager. That's the sort of upper management. And then we have middle management, all who are formerly incarcerated, an assistant warehouse manager, a resale manager, and a logistics and office manager. And then the warehouse staff, which is a mixture of mostly full-time, a couple part-time people. I want to create more jobs in that realm, right? So, I mean, I think our team is very strong. These are people who are incredibly dedicated to Isidore and to the cause of what we're doing. In 5 years, we project that if we can get the growth capital that we need within 5 years, we would have about 75 people in the warehouse. So that's the goal.
How are some ways or strategies you guys are trying to fundraise without, because you can't offer a tax incentive?
Right, so it's been a weird thing. I mean, I've gotten, there's some loans that we've gotten. We had this, it's a weird world. So basically I was told that no one would do equity in our company because what's the exit? So that's always the question, is what is the exit? What is the exit? And for us, like, I'm not creating this company to sell it to waste management one day so that they can stop hiring all the formerly incarcerated people. So I think there's growth through replication, but not necessarily that big sale that might happen. So I think that's why a lot of impact investors sort of didn't know what to do with us. So we had developed something called a subordinated variable debt payment instrument, which was essentially it's a 2x return over 7 years, but it's paid out of our free cash flow, which means that as we make money, we would slowly pay back and then double pay. So we had a few people who subscribed to that. It's very strange. It's totally weird and out there, but it kind of made sense for us and for them. We've been granted grants relatively without going after them. That's been a little bit like unsolicited. And I think that just speaks to people do want to see this model work. They just don't, beyond traditional grant giving, somewhere in between there, like we're somewhere in between traditional grant giving and that impact world. So we've had a tiny bit from the impact world and some more actually from the grant world. And then what right now is happening is that we have these loans, really excellent term loans that we're looking for, but because we're not in the black and we don't have very many assets, we need guarantors for them. So we're talking to foundations about being our guarantors, that's very exciting to them. It's sort of an innovative new way for them to use their money without actually having to put it out and be able to support a for-profit enterprise. And then now we actually do have some people wanting to talk to us about equity. So it's just throwing everything at the wall and seeing what sticks. And then we did a crowdfunding campaign, which I don't know why it took us so long, because we do have so much sort of goodwill out in the community. We might as well go for that. So we raised $40,000 that way. So yeah.
I had some questions based on your mention of receiving donations.
Yeah.
Do you have a charitable arm or fiscal sponsorship?
We have a fiscal sponsor. So we're part of the LA Clean Tech Incubator, and they are, so they're our incubator, but they're also our fiscal sponsor. So we've been able to, we did a big project with the city of LA, all those computers going up to Fresno. I stole like 10,000 of them and kept them in LA for a workforce development program. We got some funding that went through, they were sort of the manager of that project, so they went through them. But any funding is specifically earmarked basically always towards paying workers. Like it doesn't go into my pocket, it goes directly into paying for workers.
I just want to know how many people have you helped, like how many people have you hired? And if they ever leave, do they find jobs elsewhere? Like, are they easily hired?
Yep, so we've run the gamut of that. So I think through our doors, I think we've had probably about 30 people at this point, and it is everything from a guy who did 29 years in prison, came out, he was driving our truck for us, and then 4 months later got another truck driving job at double the pay, gave us 2 weeks notice, left, it was awesome. He was like, sorry, we're like, no, this is awesome. It's everything from that to, the reality of folks who are hard to employ is that they are hard to employ, and that the things that drag people down, like tickets that they, like parking tickets they got like 7 years ago that are now $2,000 parking tickets, like we've had people certainly go back to jail because things have sort of nabbed them back. We've also had people get off parole. My assistant warehouse manager got off parole a month ago. It's the first time he hasn't been under state control in 17 years. He took a month. He took 2 weeks off and like went on a road trip and like grew a beard. It was awesome. I mean, and literally, he went and did Tough Mudder in Nevada or something. And these are people who have had ankle bracelets on for years and years and years. We've had people fall off the wagon. I had someone show up at the warehouse and handed us, clearly high on meth, and handed us his pipe. We were like, okay, please don't come to work high on meth. And so it's everything from like firing people for that and making helpfully getting them the help that they need to some real success stories, like people paying down their child support and again, getting off probation and getting off parole and seeing their kids again and getting off welfare. I mean, so it's like everything under the sun. But we certainly have had people go on to other work. And we've had people who've stayed within the company and grown with us. So my assistant warehouse manager, the one that just got off parole, came to us 3 years ago. He he kept knocking on the door. We're like, this is when we were like five people. We're like, we don't have any work. And he kept coming, and he was like 40, I think, and had kicked heroin and kicked meth and was just like, I'm 40, I don't wanna go back to, I'm done, I really am. And he really was. And so we hired him, and now he's our assistant warehouse manager. It's awesome. So every story under the sun is what we've seen.
Sort of follows up on that. Do you have any challenges with stigma, both your own internal, your personal biases, and also external? I mean, potential clients or,
sure.
Everybody feels,
sure.
knows the good that you're doing, but there's
absolutely
an inherent bias in there.
Yeah, I mean, we all have our inherent
everything that's in there. Yes, I do, and we all do, and I will say for our team, it's, one of the most beautiful things I think about Isidore is that when somebody comes in for a job interview, we never ask them the question that they're dreading being asked. So we know they have a record, that's who we're looking for. And it's unbelievable to see someone sort of sit down and know, and I'll have my own, I'm like, I don't know, I don't like the way this guy looks. Like, I don't know, he seems a little gruff or whatever it is. But to see someone sit in a chair and realize that that question is not hanging over them and that they can just be a human and they're just on a job interview about who they are, it's like one of the coolest things you can ever see. On the other side of the world, not that we're perfect, but that is what we offer. That is the thing that we offer at Isidore, all of our internal biases aside. On the other side, I mean, I don't know who doesn't work with me because of who I hire, but we've had banks, hospitals, government, corporations. I mean, people, as long as our customer service is pretty great, which it is, I haven't had too much pushback on that. We do get it. I mean, yes, people are like, whoa, really? And we're like, yes, but here's the things that we have in place to make sure that the work is done well and your data is safe. And I mean, I'm sure we've had people not work with us because of it, but we've also clearly had quite a few who have. It's funny, one of my main advisors over at the Clean Tech Incubator, he was like an angel investor and he had a bunch of companies and he's like kind of a, I think he's like, no offense, like I'm a Democrat, I guess, he's a Republican. Like it was a little bit of like, hello, how are you? And I told him my business model and he was like, I don't know about that. Have you thought about hiring veterans? And I was like, hi, that's not why I'm doing this. And that's the whole thing. And I will say 2 years later, he's one of our biggest advocates. He totally gets it. And I think it is, it's so shocking for people at first because it's such a, it's such a tricky issue, formerly incarcerated, it's so tricky because we're dealing with people who really, many of them have done bad things, right? But, I mean, this is sort of my big spiel about this I think this is one of the things that we've really conveyed, which is so if someone, whatever it is that they did, if they also did their time, we gave them a punishment, we gave them their 6 months or their 18 years or whatever it is, but they did it, they took their punishment and they come out, but we never forgive them, ever. How is that fair? How is that right for society? So we're forgiving them and trying again and again to do it. And to speak to that internal bias, you can't imagine the behavior sometimes that we see. We're just like, what? Come, guys, you're at work. What? How is this a thing that you're gonna do? And people leave, leaving the job or never showing, all these crazy things. And we will give them chance after chance, not forever. We do fire people after a while, and it is a constant push against that own, even for myself to that initial reaction of someone did something bad and I'm like, punish, I'm gonna punish them, they did something bad. And to really stop and sit with that and be like, that's not the world you wanna see, right? So how do you give that second or third or fourth chance? So it's a complicated question and a complicated answer, but that's my answer.
What's your feelings on ban the box?
Right on to ban the box. I mean, that's who we are, right? We've banned the box. It's an excellent, excellent policy. It's awesome to see what's going forward with it. And I think, we've chosen who, there are certain crimes. It is not appropriate for me to hire people who have done identity theft or fraud. I don't, that's not right for my business. And I think that's the, when look, and this is, you know, the we have an interesting path ahead of us in this country in terms of how to actually deal with integrating people back into society. Like, we're not ignoring it anymore, which is awesome. So I think one of the really nuanced questions we have to deal with here is, sure, it's not appropriate for every person to like hire every crime, but how do we get into the nuance of, let's be real specific about it. Can we get more specific about it? So I know what's right for me not to hire, but can we start having that conversation in general? Like, some dude stole some weed and he can't, like, do, I don't know, like, drive a truck now? Like, it just, I don't know if that's a good example, but you know what I mean, the figuring out the best fits there.
For your company, since you guys are for profit as well as you have a social mission, how do you measure success? Is it like trying to give jobs to a certain amount of certain number of people from prison, or is it trying to get a specific revenue coming in?
It's actually very simple for us, right? So success for us will be, you know, sustainable, financial sustainability, certainly. For us, it is how many pounds we've properly recycled. And it's the amount of jobs that we have taken on and retained. And then, sure, the sort of those ancillary ones of who's gone on successfully to other work. And it's actually pretty straightforward. And it's cool because for the pounds that we've recycled, there's all these great, we have sort of a calculator that we can use, which is for every 75,000 pounds that we recycle, it's one job, it's a certain amount of toxins out of landfills, it's toxins out of the air. Like, we can actually crunch those numbers for people. It's a certain amount of taxpayer savings for everyone who doesn't go back to prison, et cetera. So the metrics are there. Today's the last day of this Indiegogo campaign that we've done. So I'm gonna show you our little video. If you guys wanna like get a t-shirt or something, you can go for it. I'm Kabira. I'm the founder and CEO of Isidore Electronics Recycling, and we're here today in our Chinatown warehouse near downtown Los Angeles. And it is here that we collect and repair and properly recycle unwanted electronics for Southern California. But we're also a social enterprise, and what that means is that we recycle things properly and that we are focused on hiring and training people who face severe barriers to work. So most of the people that work in this warehouse have spent some time in the criminal justice system. But they did their time, and they come out, and they're ready to work, and we give them an opportunity to do that here at Isidore.
My name is Jimmy, and I am the driver.
My name is Caesar, and I am an eBay. My name is Caesar, and I am an e-commerce specialist.
I'm Pierce, a repair technician.
I'm Manny, and I destroy hard drives.
My name is Shay. I'm the assistant manager at Isidore Recycling.
Hello, my name is Elvis, and I practically help out with everything in here.
My name is X-Cam. My official title at Isidore Electronic Recycling is a warehouse associate. Before I came a few months ago, I was incarcerated in prison. Did about 18 years, almost 18 years. Came out, got a few jobs here and there. Wasn't really fulfilling. Heard about this place from a company called Friends Outside. And came for an interview and got me started. I do feel like my work here is very important. It's like every day I come to work, it's like I'm saving the world one computer at a time.
So we're coming to you today because we are launching a new line of business, which is mobile data destruction. So right now we have cities and banks and companies that trust us to destroy their data completely, which we do, but we want to up our game. We want to be able to put a mobile hard drive shredder on a truck, a generator on the truck to make it work, and be able to roll up to any institution, any business, and just destroy your data on site. More peace of mind for our customers, new revenue for us, everybody wins.
Hi, my name is Lulu Cornspan, and I am the operations manager here at Isidore Electronics Recycling. By contributing to this fundraiser and helping us get a truck, we have a number of perks. These include Isidore tanks and teas, vintage electronics, pampering items like a mobile massage by the best masseuse ever. You'll get to meet President Barack Obama. That's not true. That's not it at all. But the other things are true. And at the end of all of this, we're also, through this campaign, going to be selling tickets to a big event we're throwing at Fado Dough. It's going to be a hip-hop dance party with vintage gaming. Thank you so much for your support of Isidore Electronics Recycling.
So we're hoping that you, our community, can help us get there. We have a bunch of perks. We're trying to raise $60,000 to be able to get that truck and outfit it right. So we hope you'll support us. You can help people like Jimmy. He'd be the one driving the truck. All right, thanks.
So I know you guys can help me raise the last $20,000 today. But if you do want to check it out, it's on Indiegogo, it's Isidore. And I have cards and...
This was phenomenal. Please tweet out the Indiegogo campaign.
Oh, cool.
We will certainly do it within our center and, you know, get out the word the last day. I mean, this is really inspiring. We really appreciate your time.
Thanks.
Speaking to our students about what they can do, a path that does work to really make a difference in people's lives, individual people's lives. And that's really exciting.
So that's cool. It's really hard, but it's like there's nothing more gratifying. Anything you do is going to be hard, so why not?
That's a great slogan. Anything you do that's worth walking, it's hard. So just pick something that makes a difference.
Yeah.
All right, thanks.